And joining us right now, our foreign policy expert. He knows so much about this. There's so many things that I want to ask. I want to make sure we have as much time as possible. Stephen Yates, you can find him at Yates Comms, foreign policy expert, work with the Bush administration. He knows all about this. He's been around the world, ran Radio Free Asia, communists hate him, and he's now in a new hidden bunker. So that's how important he is. He's got hidden bunkers all over the country. Stephen, it's good to see you. Just without the formal calling of it, this is a hostage situation. Do you think that's a correct assessment, or is that just hyperbole?
It is a hostage situation in that you're at the mercy of a murderous Islamist organization in order to get safe passage. Yeah, I mean, just imagine America's top law enforcement officer saying, well, Antifa controls Portland. That's just the reality we're going to have to deal with. And if you want safe passage, well, we're just going to have to negotiate with Antifa. And this is just the international allegory to that. It's an amazing expression of weakness. I wish so much that there was something positive to say about these developments, but there really aren't. It's a total destruction of everything that was built up over the last 20 years. We can debate endlessly the journey and what was mm-hmm. good or bad. I think it should have ended 10 years ago, but we don't get that luxury. But this constant weakness from the administration is just, I think, provocative.
This August 31st deadline that the Taliban said that Joe Biden has to abide by, that no extensions will be given, he really doesn't have any room for leverage. I mean, what could he possibly use at this point or do at this point to get that deadline extended? And because you're Boris Johnson saying that, you guys are going to have to probably stay past that to get Americans out. Are the Taliban, I can't even believe I'm asking this as though this is a group with which you can or is worthy of being negotiated with, but is that something that they actually would commit to, or is it just August 31st and that's their red line?
I never in my life thought it would be necessary to say that a commander-in-chief and a secretary of state and defense should be saying unequivocally that we will do everything necessary and everything within our power to safely get all Americans out of harm's way. And we don't really care about any deadlines. This is our mission. That's why we're here. And you will not stop us. I mean, really, it's as simple as that. And the fact that they are on these other topics, really, if we listen to the President of the United States contradict his own words, much less his actions being contradicted by his words, who are you going to believe? This evil Taliban spokesman saying, nope, there's no wiggle room in this deadline. Are you going to believe our own administration? And it's super, super sad to even let the words come out of your mouth that one of those guys has more credibility and it's not the one we want.
Oh, that's a horrible reality to, I mean, honestly it is, but that's the situation that we're in. I mean, do you think that the administration has the wherewithal to say, we're going to stay as long as it takes to get our people out, and if you don't let us or you try to get froggy, then we're going to meet you with like serious heavy firepower? Would they even, I mean, because they have their own serious heavy firepower that we left them.
Yeah, well, that's a travesty of itself. I mean, it's still sort of back to the suits versus boots. I have 1,000% confidence that there's a lot of highly motivated, capable people with all the material they need to do this. And it's somewhat shamefully been put out on the international media, truthfully. You know what? If the French can do this and the British can do this, what possible claim is there that the Americans can't do this? This is 100% a policy decision, a political decision, polluting the reality. So there's really no other way to put it. We could, we should, but right now, according to the president, we're just not gonna.
Yeah. And the area around the airport, not secure. And then, of course, over the weekend, Stephen, we heard talking to Stephen Yates that ISIS-K, the K variant of the terror virus, has rolled in from the Khorasan province. And from what I understand and enlighten people for us, they are the worst aspect of, they're like ISIS, but worse. And none of the other terror groups will let them sit with them because they think they're so bad, they make terrorism look bad. Is that kind of accurate? That's what I've heard.
Well, my first exposure to K was through the movies Men in Black. So, I mean, I have a very positive association with this. But in seriousness, we're dealing with what I would call the Baskin and Robbins of Islamic Jihad, where there's all kinds of different terrorist networks, radical networks, they have different histories, different roles and missions, but what they have in common is the marriage of mosque and state, which is Islamism broadly, imposed by way of Sharia law, and they are willing to kill in order to impose it. Some of them have broader international designs. Some of them, yeah, they're just content to control their locality, but they have these commonalities. The ISIS variant, if people might sadly remember during the Obama administration when they had some of the most brutal forms of execution and torture recorded on the hell site known as YouTube and put out for the world to see, they are some of the worst of the worst. And it was spawned out of a disorderly retreat from Iraq, another display of unnecessary weakness. I agreed with the idea of drawing things to a close, but the way we did it empowered the worst of the worst. And guess what? Now they've survived, and everyone's going to take a summer in Afghanistan now, because guess what? President chose the fighting season in order to pull this off.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I was trying to tell people that actually is the thing in Afghanistan, where we have pumpkin spice season here in the United States. In Afghanistan, they have fighting season, because of course, I mean, after, you know, before you're going to go to the fields and harvest the poppies, you know, got to get that heroin cash crop. They fight and then they go to the fields. Then they go up north in the mountains. Everybody, Taliban settle down. Then they come back. It's a site. It's been going on for ages, correct?
It's comical in a certain sense. I mean, everything has a time and season. There's business and there's real business, but it is part of the biorhythm, and it's not a reality that snuck up on us. This is something that we have had our heads deeply into for 20 years. So it's another one of those things where I am as much a critic of deep state and bureaucrats and the swamp and all that as anyone else. And at the same time, there's the stop clock theorem would hold. They're right some of the time. They knew this stuff. I don't believe they didn't tell the president this.
Yes.
I don't believe that the cabinet didn't know this. They wilted and let basically a jello brain president move forward with something that is now killing people and damaging our national interests. I have no patience for it.
Yeah, we're talking with Stephen Yates at Yates Comms. One of the things that I kept seeing kind of somewhat reported, and I also was, because now I'm wearing my tinfoil hat fully with the story. I kept thinking, wow, this would be a great CIA op. This is just like, it's going to be like a Netflix special or something. Because there's discussion of the Panjshir Valley in the Hindu Kush. And of course, that's the Valley of Resistance. That's where the last resistance happened. In the 80s, apparently the Soviets tried to take it over. Shah Massoud fought them. Now his son, he was assassinated like in 2002. Now his son is taking over, and they flew the flag of resistance, if you want to believe that that's a current photo. And there were all of these clips. It looks to be expertly peppered throughout social media, which immediately makes me curious. But what are your thoughts of that? Because I keep thinking, oh, well, if people want to have a resistance, that's fine. But I don't think that that's anything that the U.S. needs to get involved in. I mean, what's the likelihood of them even being successful taking Afghanistan back from Taliban?
Well, I have no way to gauge how successful or unsuccessful this particular movement would be, but it's important to kind of keep in mind that the natural state of nature for Afghanistan is warlordism. Hmm. It's not a unified state with a central government, with effective rule, and a unitary culture, language, et cetera, et cetera. It's this disaggregated warlordism. And to the extent that this is a warlord kingdom that can hold on, there's a tough geography that protects these separate fiefdoms. It was actually some of the network that we used after 9/11 in the military campaign to unseat the Taliban government. So there is a chance. And it's one of those things that as we've watched this dystopian movie of the Communist Party of China and now Islamists and the Taliban roll over people who had been struggling for their freedom, while the world gives up, while the president of the United States might give up, some of these people are faced with a fight or die situation, and they choose fight. They didn't have flee as an option. And whether it's people in Hong Kong who continue to resist overwhelming odds, or whether it's these guys who might have retreated to a safe haven, I kind of respect them. I don't know that there's a lot we can do. If we can occasionally make something go boom to allow them to be safe, I support that kind of an idea. But it's not our job to go in, hold, and expand that territory. Yeah. That's just not, I think, the lesson of the last 20 years.
Last question. This has to do with China's interest in Afghanistan, because according to a Pentagon memo that circulated when Biden was VP during the Obama era, it was known that Afghanistan is the Saudi Arabia of lithium. Of course, they have a lot more rare earth elements than lithium, but they are loaded with lithium. Obviously, no one's been able to get in there and do anything because they're crazy. I mean, you have, as you were just telling us about, warlords, terrorists, you know, cats and dogs living together. It's mass chaos. And so China would love to do this Belt and Road Initiative like they've done with so many different African nations. Not quite sure that that would actually, they might be overestimating their influence or their ability to influence in Afghanistan. But, and this is a crazy theory I have or a proposal, what's to stop, I don't know, somebody gun running? I mean, if Biden's going to gun run, how about you gun run to the Xinjiang province, which is pretty close to Afghanistan right there? I think a part of it borders, and maybe, I don't know, give some guns to the Uyghurs and then have the Taliban wage terrorism on China. But then I might be overestimating Taliban's concern for anything other than their bottom line, because they also kind of hate their own Muslim population. Your thoughts?
Yeah, well, there is a tension in the sense when we're talking about these various offshoots of the Islamist movement. The parts of it that really care about controlling and governing Afghanistan, they had common cause with al-Qaeda and others to push the Soviets out. So they don't necessarily have a loving relationship with Russia. They are suspicious of the Chinese in a certain sense. I would love it if the American military, industrial, and intelligence complex could engage in political warfare and maybe even some other hot missions to make life hard for our enemies, like the theocratic regime in Iran and like the communist regime in China. In my lifetime, they have never proven to have a high enough IQ and acumen to pull this off. I pray that that day shall come. But there is, I think, a certitude that China will seek an economic advantage and a strategic advantage. It's important to know that the top communist leadership met with top Taliban diplomatic representatives mm-hmm. just days before this flip happened.
They knew.
And they launched their propaganda videos, pivoting off of this change nearly immediately. So they have been in some kind of strategic simpatico with this new Taliban regime, and we have to watch out for that, and we should disrupt it.
Yeah, and how is the big question. And with this administration, I think we might be overestimating them as well. We're out of time today, but I could talk to you about this for an hour longer. Stephen Yates at Yates Comms. Everybody can go check his thoughts out on Twitter about this. It's a place to go. Stephen, always good to see you. Thank you so much, my friend. And by the way, happy early birthday. Happy 21st birthday. You can now legally drink. Congratulations.
It's about time.
Take care, my friend. Thanks so much.